So today we will be talking about personalization in the context of Big Basket, and we'll be talking about a couple of things. Why we think personalization is important, that's the first thing. The second thing is what is our approach to personalization, and the third would be what is the analytics stack that helps in achieving personalization. So those are the three things that we want to talk about. So I mean, just to summarize, why personalization, what are some trends that we are observing, then some practical steps, then we also want to show what we think personalization will look like in the future, and lastly Mani will take us through the analytics stack at Big Basket. Now, why personalization? I think one of the more obvious things is to maintain customer context. So for example, if you're taking an Uber cab, you want to know, you want the app to know where you are currently and ideally where you'd like to go. So you want the app to maintain customer context. You'd also want the app to maintain things like your payment information and so on and so forth. I think that part is pretty obvious, so I'll not spend much time on that. And I think a lot of apps, most apps today do that part really well. I think almost any app that you take, they store customer details, they save your payment details and so on and so forth. And I think since most apps do that today already, we'll not spend too much time on that. But I think this part is quite interesting. And here the way we look at this is, over time, right, what happens is the amount of information available increases dramatically. And that's true regardless of which industry you take. So for example, if you take Spotify, the number of songs keeps growing day on day on day. And likewise with Big Basket, we keep adding assortment every day, right? So that keeps growing over time. But then if you look at a human being, the processing ability remains constant throughout time. So, I mean, the time that you have is finite, and even within the time that you have, you can't really, you know, go through, you know, say more than 10 songs in 5 minutes. So I think there are limitations on human capacity, and that's why we think personalization can play a role. So here there's this ever widening gap between the information that's available and the processing ability per human, right? And one other interesting thing to note is that, you know, in the offline world, you're constrained by shelf space. So there's limited shelf space, and you're optimizing for, you know, how do you get the right items on the shelves? And so for example, I mean, to give a real example, suppose you were to go to a supermarket, in 1 hour, you'll probably cover, in a supermarket, typically the assortment is 5,000 to 10,000 items. And typically you might spend a half an hour or an hour, you know, going through the store. And you might be able to cover a decent chunk of the assortment in during that time. On the other hand, if you look at any e-commerce website, for example, if you take an Amazon or a Flipkart or a Big Basket, most of these companies have tens of thousands of products listed, and it's just impossible for a person to actually go through that assortment in any reasonable amount of time. And that's why we think personalization can play a role. Anyone recognize who this is? You can read the quote, and you know, anyone who can identify who this is, you know, we can probably get some goodies for them. I mean, one of the interesting things that you note here is that this was actually, you know, this quote is from 1971, you know, it's 40 years back. And what it says, for those of you who can't read at the back, is it says that a wealth of information creates a poverty of attention and a need to allocate that attention efficiently. To be an attention conserver, an information system, processing system, must be an information condenser. So this this was actually said by Herbert Simon, who was one of the pioneers of AI, and you know, he was also active in social sciences and so on and so forth. So what he said in 1971 is that he kind of saw this coming. He saw that the volume of information is going to explode, and we are just seeing the effects of that over the last 10 years or so. So explosion of information and limited processing ability of human beings, and the only way to solve it is if you kind of distill or condense the amount of information to fit an individual appropriately. So, and that's what personalization is all about, right? Now let's look at some trends and you know, which illustrate how personalization has really caught on. So I think this is Taobao, which is part of the Alibaba group, one of the largest e-commerce websites in the world. So out of 100 product page views, right? Out of 100 product page views, if you split it by search and recommendations, today Taobao receives more of its product page views from recommendations than by search, So that's data point number one. And one of the things, I mean, if you really think about it, is that this would only happen if the quality of recommendations is very relevant. So that's one data point. The second data point is this company called Stitch Fix. What Stitch Fix does, it's an American company, and what they do is that you know, you fill out a form where you reveal your preferences on apparel. So you say that I like a particular type of fit, I like, say, Indian clothing or Western clothing, and so on and so forth. So you spend 15 minutes filling out a questionnaire on your preferences, and note that there's no browse answer nor search. So all you do is you reveal your preferences, and Stitch Fix, what Stitch Fix does is, it based on what you reveal, it kind of figures out what are the kind of clothes that you would like and what would suit you, and they'll send you a package of 5 items of clothing which are delivered to your doorstep, right? The interesting thing to note here, as I said, is there's absolutely no browse, there's no search. All that they do is they obtain your preferences from you, and based on your feedback. So for example, if you get 5 items of clothing and you return 3 of them, then they figure out based on that feedback what to send you next time. So it's completely recommendation based. The entire company is based on recommendations. That's data point number 2. The third is Amazon. I think this you can just, as an experiment, just scroll through. Many of you might have noticed this. So just scroll through your Amazon app homepage, and just observe the number of widgets that are dedicated to personalization. So I mean, to cut a long story short here, you'll notice that you know, maybe at least 20 to 30% of the homepage on the app, which is their most prime real estate, is dedicated to personalized recommendations. And these come in several flavors. So for example, it could be items that you browsed, or customers who bought X also bought Y, and things of that sort. But between all of those different flavors of recommendation, maybe 20 to 30% of the app is filled by personalized recommendations. That's data point number 3. Data point number 4 is something that all of us are super familiar with, which is Facebook. I mean, it's so kind of in the air nowadays that we don't even pause to reflect on it. It's Facebook's newsfeed, which is 100% driven by recommendations since 2006. So if you remember earlier, right, with the likes of Orkut and the early days of Facebook, you actually had to go to every one of your friends' walls and, you know, check out their posts individually. And what newsfeed did was to kind of synthesize all of that content and show you the relevant, only the pieces of content that were relevant to you. So of, say, the 100 pieces of content that you might be eligible to see, they might pick out the one that is absolutely relevant to you. So that's Facebook. So I think what all of this is telling us is that, you know, personalized recommendations are really catching on. I think some companies have really gone down that route, the whole hog, the likes of Facebook and Stitch Fix. But, you know, companies like Taobao and Amazon are not too far behind. Now, what's the approach to personalization? I think that's something to ponder. I think one of the things that we've realized over the years is that, I mean, the most prominent types of algorithms that are spoken about are things like customers who bought X also bought Y. But I think it's worth reflecting whether that kind of recommendation works for your category. And we'll go into that in a bit of, in a couple of slides. So no, and the single biggest learning for us is that it's very important to know the category. I think it's worth learning what Amazon has done and the kind of algorithms that they are using. But I think it's very important to know the category and to tailor your personalization according to the category. That's the first. The second is enriching data. I think in order for all this personalization to work, it's very, very important to have, you know, for example, if you take a book, know as many dimensions of the book as possible. Or if you take a movie, understanding, you know, whether it's a horror, Western, 1970s movie based in India. I think it's very important to know the data at a very granular level. That's the second. And the third is, you know, I mean, just some thoughts on how the future might look like. Now, the first is know the category. I think, so here, I'll just read out each of these. So, if, I mean, and here, I mean, just to make the point clear, right, let's take books as a category and compare it with groceries, right, which is where Big Basket operates. So, in the case of a book, you're going to buy a book exactly once in a lifetime, right? or at most two if you want to give it to someone else. In the case of groceries, there are a lot of items that you buy repeatedly. So that's point number one. The second is that, in books as a category, right? Even if you buy different books, I buy a book, even if you buy different books, it's not super regular. So I might buy a book this month, but not buy a book for 3 months together, right? Whereas on the other hand, groceries category that you buy typically every week. So there's a very big difference in the regularity of purchase. That's second. Third is in books, it's all about discovery of relevant books. You just want to know, can I identify books that I'm interested in? So that's the only thing that you're worried about. In the case of grocery, there are two things that you need to worry about. First is, of course, you want to discover relevant products. But at the same time, you also want to, if you're buying a particular set of 10 items regularly, you also want those 10 items to be super accessible to you when you want it. That's the third. The fourth is that collaborative filtering, the classic algorithm that Amazon started off with, it works beautifully in books. But in the case of Big Basket, right, suppose you were buying potatoes, and with all my processing, if I recommend onions to you, it's not going to be super interesting, right? We want to show something that's somewhat interesting to you. So, taking an algorithm that works in one category and just putting it in grocery just doesn't work, right? Or it might work, but with some tweaking. That's the fourth. And fifth is, in a book, you might have an affinity to, say, John Grisham or a particular author or a Dan Brown. In the case of groceries, the affinity might be to, say, a brand of atta, like an Ashirwad or something like that, right? So it's very important to know what are the category-specific behaviors, in your category. And, when we started going down this route of personalization, we spent quite a bit of time doing this. And, just as a couple of, practical tips, that might help. I think one of the things that that helps is, if there's an offline parallel, it's worth observing how people behave in an offline world. I think that helps. The second thing that helps is if, let's say, you take your own customer, take yourself as a customer and go very deep into your own buying pattern, right? Just observe your buying over, say, a 12-month period. And, it's super anecdotal and very, it involves looking at every order for a long period of time. But I think that deep analysis of a few orders really helps in understanding category. And the third thing that helps is, going back to data and, trying to understand, discern some patterns in data. So for example, if you find that, it takes, after 3 or 4 orders of buying organic staples, people have a propensity to also try organic vegetables. Suppose that's a data point that you discern from data. That's something that you can very easily use in your personalization efforts. So just to recap here, I think in order to know the category, it helps to kind of deep dive into specific orders. It also helps to kind of look at patterns in data before you even start down the road of personalization. The second part is enriching the data. And here, there's a really good article, on how Netflix reverse engineered Hollywood. I think that kind of tells you everything that one needs to know about tagging. One of the things to note here, so what Netflix tries to identify is if I like, say, gritty westerns set in the 1970s, if they're able to find that out, they can show me more movies that are gritty westerns set in the 1970s. And an offshoot of this way of thinking is that you need to know exactly what a movie is and what are its characteristics. And the only way to do that is if you have people who have an interest in movies and who know movies, tag every one of these movies individually. And in fact, that's exactly what Netflix does. They actually have people, who are, say, film school graduates and who like movies, actually tagging every movie. And it's a very, it involves a lot of painstaking effort, but it seems to pay off for them, right? And in some cases, right, I believe there are also companies, for example, in the food space, there are companies that actually help you tag, given a set of SKUs, they help you tag those SKUs with, say, nutritional information and whether it's organic and so on and so forth. So you could go down that route as well. So that's tagging. And lastly, I'll read this out. So one of the things we were trying to visualize is how how a message, a personalized message might look in the future, and hopefully this is not too far away in the future. So I mean, this is all imaginary stuff. So what it says is, hey Amit, we think you'd like organic sour soap, and here's how it looks. So I mean, that's a picture of organic sour soap, and next it goes on to say, we thought you'd like it because you seem to like strawberries and apple, and sour soap tastes a bit like both, right? So in order to kind of write the second sentence, you need to know that sour soap has flavor characteristics of strawberries and apples. So that's something that you need to tag, have tagged earlier. So that's the second line. Also, this is the first time we've introduced organic sour soap, and you seem to prefer organic products. So here you need to know a couple of things. One is that organic sour soap is a new product that we've introduced. And the second is, you need to know that Amit likes organic products. Again, that can be done by crunching data. And then it goes on to say, and oh, by the way, there's been a 10% price drop for this product since the last time you visited our app. For this, this again is like, you know, you can, you know, generate it based on data. And lastly, it says, with your preferred Citibank credit card, there's a 20% cashback on Big Basket. And this is very easy to figure out, you know, it's very easy to figure out based on transaction data, what type of payment method a customer is using. So that's what it says. And lastly, this this goes out as an email at 10 a.m. on Wednesday, which over time we figured out is the right time to send an email to Amit. So, I mean, this is a message from the future, and today we're using, we are doing different elements of it. So for example, you know, I mean, name personalization is something that a lot of people do. Figuring out if a customer likes organic, that's something that we can do as well. Likewise with price drops, and figuring out payment methods. All of these are very much doable today, but I think it's all in, you know, maybe we might do it a little manually, or it's not, you know, it's not feasible to do it all together in one shot in an automated way. And that's basically what we're working on. And I'll, you know, hand it over to Mani to explain exactly how we think of our analytics stack to support the way we are looking at personalization.
So as Anand introduced, I'm the head of analytics. And while all of us within Big Basket are focused on our external customers and focusing on delighting them, delivering a great customer experience, internally, Anand and team are our customers. And so we focus on sort of enabling their ultimate goal, which is to be able to deliver a very personalized experience for a customer, either through online or offline assets that we have. The online assets being our app, and the offline assets being our email and PN communication. So to do that and to sort of get to the ultimate goal that Anand and team have, we build an ecosystem that is sort of evolving to get to that point. So the ecosystem that we have today, internally we call that as Analytics Avatar 2.0. We were in 1.0, where it was essentially mass communication, very limited personalization, to 2.0, where I'd argue that maybe 50% of or more of the stuff that we do is personalized. And the goal is to be able to get to something like this, which is 100% personalized. So a lot of text there, but I'll quickly summarize what we're talking about. To be able to deliver growth, to be able to deliver a personalized experience, you've got to do three things from an analytics perspective. Number one is collect all sources of data. Yeah. Collect all sources of data and sort of figure out a way to aggregate, sort it. And then begin to build models on top of that that can help deliver the results that you're looking for. So those are the three steps. And I have some examples for each of those to tell you how that works. But let's start with the first one, which is being able to collect all sources of data. While with cloud computing and other technological evolutions that have happened, this is increasingly becoming an easier challenge. You still have to build for scale. Our data volumes, for example, have grown 1,000-fold in just the last 3 years. Because of the fact that we decided to bring in all sorts of data into the data warehouse, using all interactions that a customer has with Big Basket. So what it allows us to do is to sort of clean, transform the data, and build the data warehouse as a single source of truth. So Anand and team are not sort of battling the question on whether the data is accurate or not. They sort of move on with their campaigns, knowing that the data that they have in the warehouse is a defined source of truth, it's clean. And that when they send a communication to a customer using the information that's in the data warehouse, it's guaranteed to be accurate and therefore engage the customer, right? And so that's taken some amount of effort to get us to this point. And A metric that sort of helps us recognize that is the fact that, you know, from 2 years ago, when we look at our channels of traffic into our app, Big Basket is a channel of traffic that we use. The name there denotes traffic generated by Big Basket using its emails, PNs. That would be, you know, X percentage, and that's actually in the last 2 years gone up 10 times, right? Because it's become a critical source of traffic and a reliable source of traffic, powered obviously by the, you know, the single source of truth, clean version of data that we've been able to build. The second element to this is to sort of crunch the time that the marketing team needs or gets to act on the data. Version 1.0 would take about 24 plus hours before we knew what happened on the ground or with customer experience, whereas we are increasingly crushing that. The minimum now is about 3 hours, and we want to get to a point where it's all real-time streaming. While it's very aspirational to think about real-time streaming, etc., it's also important to recognize what are use cases that you will use that requires real-time streaming data. And so we strike a balance. There are cases today where with about 3 to 4 hours lag, there is data available that allows us to engage with customers, particularly when things go wrong, so that we let the customer know that something went wrong and it's fixed and please come back. But there are also other use cases that we want to begin to think about where we could use real-time data. But it, again, as I said, the use cases are important. We are not, you know, an e-commerce app where someone comes in, buys a kilo of tomato and walks away. So if they added a kilo of tomato to the basket and it's been 6 hours since then, it's not the right time to tell them that tomatoes are waiting for you, because they typically build a basket. It's about 10 items, 12 items before they check out. So real-time has its place when it comes to our world, where basket building is very common, right? So that's why we're, you know, focusing on finding the right use cases that need real-time engagement. So those are a couple of things that have happened, which has helped us sort of build better customer engagement, provide reports, dashboards that help teams make decisions, as well as sort of help collaboration happen between teams, brands, partners, and so on. So that's just come from collecting all sorts of data, cleaning them up, and storing them. The next is to be able to aggregate that data. And Anand referred to this when he talked about enriching the data. So the raw data or even the transformed data is only of certain value when it comes to personalization. One of the goals within Big Basket is not to ever reach out to the customer and ask them, are you married? Do you have kids? Do you work? Is it double income household? Are you vegan? Are you organic? And so on. We could easily do that. We could set up a form and get that information. But the, you know, the challenge is we see that as a roadblock in the experience that the customer will have on the app. We also realize that there's a lot of data that the customer is giving us using their browsing behavior, using their transactional behavior, that helps us deduce a lot of this information. Again, something that sets us apart when it comes, you know, when you compare with others like an Ola or Uber, is that a lot of things that happen on the app with Big Basket is not for an individual, but for the household. So a lady in the house is shopping for the household, or a gent is shopping on the app for the household. And so it's not just about figuring out what that gentleman is doing or what the lady is doing on the app, and therefore deducing their gender or their preferences, but deducing a lot of the other information that is happening through transactions as well as browsing behavior to build a profile of the household itself. And so that's the enrichment that we focus on. So some of the evolving techniques here is to be able to build a 360-degree profile of the customer with a lot of key value pairs, tags that describe that customer, which is sort of validated. And some of the initial steps that we're taking there is to build a coded profile of the customer using just their buying behavior and browsing behavior to be able to say that this is a household that has mixed genders. And we could also, using some information, be able to deduce if that is a married household or a unmarried household. Are there kids, and not just kids, but be able to say that, are these kids less than 3 years old, or are these kids greater than 3 years old? And all of this rich information, therefore, then becomes very valuable to the marketing team to sort of tailor the communication and personalize the communication. For example, you don't want to send a notification or an email or an offer about diapers to a household that clearly does not have kids. It sort of dents your credibility, and therefore it's very critical to understand that. And even err on the side of the caution, if you've not seen any transaction from their side, from the household side, related to baby products, you know, leave them out of the cohort and message the rest of the cohort where you have high levels of confidence. So the segmentation logic that we're building, the sort of profiling that we're building for our customers, has a confidence level. And therefore, it allows the marketing team to say that, you know what, this campaign, for example, I'm willing to go with households where you have 50% or more confidence, versus another campaign where they could say, I want to target households here that are where you have 80% confidence that they are organic buyers and so on. So it's a combination of being able to attach a label to the customer and a confidence level that allows the marketing teams and the category teams to make decisions on what level of confidence they want to work with. So that's something that's happened. And as I said, all of this has happened while the data volumes have grown thousandfold. And why has that happened? We focus on collecting data from our customers across all their interactions with us. A lot of the interactions actually happen on the app or the website. When they come to the app, when they browse the app, when they add items to their cart, when they decide to buy, and when they actually place the order. So all of this happens, but a lot of it happens outside the app. When a delivery person visits the facility to deliver, when the person returns item, the household member who got the delivery is not happy with an item or ordered an item by mistake and wants to return it. So these are actions that are happening offline, which gets captured and also flows back so that we recognize that when an item got delivered, it doesn't necessarily mean that the customer actually bought it, that there could be returns, and we recognize that and therefore be more meaningful in our communication. You don't want to send them a message saying you love the last delivery of strawberries when in fact they returned it, right? And so it's critical to capture all sources of information. So we focus on building a model that captures all the 360 degree level of interactions that are happening with our customers. Lastly, when you've aggregated data, when you've enriched data, when you've built some of your KPIs on top of it that helps you understand the engagement that's happening with the customer, you're now beginning to think about building models that can enhance the personalization. Again, as Anand pointed out, there are flavors that you see today when it comes to e-commerce companies. There are those that are fairly static when it comes to delivering user experience. Some like Amazon that probably are 20-30% sort of personalized, and Facebook that's gone all the way to 100%, almost creating a walled garden. So we want to find that sweet spot that allows customers to get a personalized experience, but also experience things that others are experiencing. So in that quest, there are a bunch of things that we do that sort of helps personalize the experience for customers. A smart basket, I don't know how many of you are familiar, and I've used it when you come to the app, if you shop with Big Basket. It's truly personalized. It recognizes your own buying behavior, and not just that, it recognizes that when it comes to toothpaste, in your family, there are three different folks. Somebody uses Colgate, somebody uses Dabur, somebody uses Pepsodent, and will recognize all three are being simultaneously used and puts all three in the basket. But if you are someone that experimented with Colgate the first time, was not happy, moved to Pepsodent, was not happy, moved to Dabur, and now settled on Dabur, it will recognize that and therefore have only Dabur in your smart basket, right? And so that's a 100% personalized experience. It's not a bunch of recommendations built on what others are buying, but based on what you're buying, what you're churning out of, what you like, and so on. The other is recommendations, which is what, again, Anand brought up when he talked about collaborative filtering. So, you know, we continue to work on it and sort of refine the algorithm so that the recommendations become meaningful. Like you said, it's not a moment for a customer when they get a recommendation on onion when they bought potatoes, right? But you want to recognize that in their basket along with potatoes, they have maybe a certain type of juice. And people that buy the juice also buy something else. And not just because they buy, you know, others bought that, but that there's a close relationship between these two individuals in terms of their buying behavior and therefore generate recommendations. So we want to go beyond your item. We want to probably get to, you know, the territory of user collaboration to be able to match a Gujarati in Bangalore whose buying behavior is very similar to a Gujarati in Ahmedabad and be able to recognize items from our portfolio in Bangalore that sort of is to the liking of the Gujarati customer here in Bangalore, right? And so that's the ultimate goal that we are driving to. What this has done are a bunch of things for us. One, clearly reduce the time to shop while increasing the cart size, and also helps us analyze and understand the customer behavior so that we continue to remove the roadblocks that the customers face when it comes to the shopping experience. While most companies have sort of bet on brand names to understand user behavior on the app with clickstream solutions, we've chosen Snowplow, which is an open source analytics tool, and it's worked wonderfully well for us to help understand user behavior on the app and on the website. And what impact has it delivered? Clearly, data tells us across cohorts that customers that use Smart Basket are able to finish their shopping in 40% lesser time while not missing out on any product. Therefore, the cart sizes for them are 50% greater than those customers that don't use the Smart Basket. Similarly, recommendations, again, going back to what Anand pointed out, a lot of the baskets of grocery customers are repeat purchases. 10% of the items are typically new items, at least for very mature customers. So we want to make sure that all the 10% comes from recommendations that we generate. So today it's at about 10% of all those 10% recommendations. But we want to continue to personalize that and through that sort of enrich the customer experience. Lastly, talking about the clickstream solution that's allowing us to sort of understand the browsing behavior and tailor the experience for customers, we've been able to do it at a fraction of the cost that it would take to implement an industry standard solution. So it's about 10% of the cost at which we are able to do this. So that's a quick summary of what we've been able to do on the analytics platform with version 2.0 to support the marketing team when it comes to delivering a personalized experience for our customers while powering growth for BigBasket. I have some quick slides that I'll use to sort of illustrate the callouts here. This is the analytics stack. Sorry, I expected this to come out a lot better, but talks about different applications from which data gets generated, the data sources through which it passes through, the extraction, the transformation, and the loading. So we use Redshift and a combination of S3 on AWS to power all of our machine learning, AI, data science solutions, and the outbounds are through microservices, through S3, through dashboards, reports, and so on. This continues to evolve, but this is a quick snapshot of our analytics ecosystem. Getting to the specifics, again, I don't know how readable this is, but this is what the marketing team is able to deliver. And clearly, the click-through rates are sort of beginning to hit new benchmarks for us when it comes to what we're able to deliver to our customer. So these are examples where clearly my past buying behavior is used to communicate to me. The first example talks about the fact that my previous order had detergents and dishwash items, and therefore calls out the fact that right now there's a 50% off on a variety of dishwash items and detergent items. The next one recognizes that I'm a heavy-duty buyer of fruits and vegetables, particularly fruits in that, and therefore recommends a great offer on avocados, which I've never tried before, and brings that out in the top of the season for me to sort of buy an experience. The third is personalized from a name perspective. It addresses me directly and also talks about what is going on, again, based on my prior buying behavior, on products that I have an affinity to, on which there are great discounts. So the last one clearly recognizes multiple attributes of me about the fact that I'm part of the loyalty program, had significant savings, and I'm someone that looks for savings and therefore drives that message clearly through that to tell me that, point me to a landing page that'll give me more offers or details about more offers. So this is sort of the personalized experience through communication that we want to deliver, but I'll also show you the personalization that comes on the app itself. So here are some of the assets that exist. The first couple of them are on the homepage. The others are embedded into the app itself on other pages, which is again completely personalized. So this is putting us on the path to get to near 100% personalization for the customer. The smart baskets, as I said, is truly personalized for you, built completely based on just your buying experience. Recommendations, again, personalized for you based on what you're likely to need or buy based on customers like you. And lastly, frequently bought together, again, is a machine learning solution that exists on the power page, on the product pages, where when customers come to buy something, it recommends other products that are very similar to that product. All of these deliver that superior customer experience, personalized in nature, which is what is powered by the analytics solution and driven by the marketing team. So that's a quick summary of what I wanted to share with you, and we are now open to taking questions. So if it's marketing, personalization, Anand is your man, but if it's tech, analytics, stack, et cetera, I can help you with the answers.
Any questions? Probably tags like organic, non-organic, for probably meats, fresh foods or others, right? But how do you generally go out and validate that, hey, this is going to work for us?
Yeah. So I think this is the most important question, actually. Given that there's a huge volume of data, how do you ensure that you don't, you use data appropriately and in a way that's useful to the customer? That's actually the most important question. And the answer to that comes from, I think the way to address it is by understanding the category and understanding customer buying behavior. If one understands category buying behavior, customer buying behavior, I think then the kind of ideas that occur will be aligned with what a customer typically does. So I think that's the way we try to solve it, because otherwise, the number of segments that you can generate or the number of ways you can personalize, it's infinite. So the only way you can narrow it is by understanding buying behavior. It can be both. I think what we've come to believe now is it's probably better to start off with some insight based on our observation and validate that with historical data, and then try to personalize based on that. Because from the data, you'll get infinite patterns. I don't know of a way in which you can, take that data as a starting point and generate, the right insights. So we start, we've tried both, but increasingly our preference is to start off with some intuition and some observations and then validate that with data and try to use that in personalization.
Hey, Anand. Hey, so that was a good presentation, so thank you. So I was basically looking at, are you now more less focused on acquisition, more on churn, or how is this personalization, is it helping your acquisition attributions or is it helping your churn rate, getting better at your churn rates?
Yeah. So, I mean, ideally, thanks, that's, ideally, in fact, we were just discussing this today. Ideally, we would love to personalize our communications towards acquisition as well. The problem there is you don't have much data. So if there's a new visitor, there's maybe a few attributes along which you can personalize your communications. For example, maybe you've browsed some items or you've kind of done some searches. It's possible to do a little bit of personalization based on that. But while we would love to use personalization for acquisition, it seems a little tough simply due to the paucity of data. So right now, most of our emphasis, almost 100% of our emphasis with personalization is on, not just reducing churn, but also generating, trials of new categories, new products, and so on and so forth.
So I also don't see referrals with Big Basket. So is it because your net promoter score, you're still working on it, or is it not part of your strategy? Or
you're saying referral, you're not seeing referrals.
Yeah, net promoter scores and your referrals. So
the question is, you're not seeing referrals as a source of traffic for us?
I'm just trying to understand, do you have referrals traffic? Do you have users?
Do you mean I refer a friend and the friend gets something?
Correct. Yeah.
Why don't we use that?
Right.
I think, so we used to have that we still have that going on a very small scale. We ran it for 3 years or so. And I think it worked really well during that time. I think over time, however, we realized that it wasn't terribly incremental, meaning that the experiment we ran was we shut off the channel for a while and saw if it resulted in a decrease of acquisitions. It didn't result in such a big decrease in acquisitions. It worked well while it lasted, but I think for whatever reason, the phase we are in right now, it doesn't seem to be very incremental, and so we're not running it right now.
Can you share what's the percent of traffic you get from notifications, and also what's the uplift you saw when you did personalization? What's the uplift in CTR?
I think the first data point I won't be able to share, unfortunately. The second, the uplift is on average in the region of 50% in terms of CTR. Yeah.
And did you see any differences in terms of Chinese mobiles versus, or did you do something to like increase the notification delivery rate in those mobiles?
Delivery rates.
Or like CTRs, did you see any difference in CTRs for people with Chinese mobiles or people with
I think, so I think there are two parts to this. One is delivery rate and the other is CTR. I think delivery rate is, it remains within a certain range. I think in the industry, as far as I know, it's anywhere between, it depends on the size of the base as well. So if it's a super active base, it's fairly high, the 70s, 80s range, 80% range. If it's a really large base, it's as low as 35, 40. And I think it's usually stayed in that range, so we don't try to do much regarding that. There are, from time to time, there are solutions like push amplification that you might try, but that's one part of it. I think where personalization has helped is, out of 100 deliveries that you get, forgetting deliverability for a while, assuming that you're able to deliver to 100 devices, for those 100 devices that you're able to deliver, it increases click-through rates, and that's the way we prefer to look at it.
Thank you.
Can we go a little deeper into a deliverability, just one real more? What kind of a technology, I'll join in late, so sorry if I'm not heard of thing. So are you using MoEngage or another platform? And what kind of a route you're doing to maximize the delivery for push notification across this thing? Like there's a one way of doing it, like a direct FCM route versus another, which is a pub server.
Yeah, so I'll answer that. I think our approach is that I think there are two things you can work on. One is improve deliverability and the other is improve CTR. And our focus is entirely on, there are lots of things that platforms do, like a MoEngage, do to improve deliverability. We trust that they'll continue doing that and do a good job of that. I think, given that we have a pretty small team and we want to focus on a few things, our entire focus has been only on the CTR part. And we assume that the deliverability over time improves, takes care of itself.
Okay, just one more follow-up question on same. What is the reliability on CRM to reach out to your own user versus remarketing, paid remarketing?
Yeah. So we do both. And the reason being that, as you were mentioning, right, I think delivery rates, especially if you take a large base comprising a lot of inactive customers who don't have the app, you will never be able to reach them with push notifications. And as a result, we try, I mean, we always do both remarketing as well as push notifications. I think remarketing is fairly, I mean, fairly cheap in terms of reaching existing customers. So we do tend to do both.
Hi, good evening. So I have one question very specific to product. So with so much data at your disposal and the personalization being your strategy, you know, where you're moving towards 100% personalization, do you have the design of a trust-based system in your product as an afterthought, or would it be something which you're going to think about it right from the word go, you know, for the customers who you're going to be onboarded soon?
When you talk about trust, can you tell us more? What do you mean by trust?
A lot of customer data are at your disposal, right? So how do I as a customer very sure about it, this is not going to be misused, or you know, something which is going to be used against me or something of that sort? For example, Cambridge Analytica, you know, the Facebook data was leaked and things like that.
Understood. So I'll take that question, because all the data sets in the analytics data warehouse. Number one, the answer to that question is a large percentage of BigBasket's employees themselves are customers. And therefore, you know, we clearly know what data means when it comes to our customers. Second part of it is no data goes outside of BigBasket walls, right? If at all there is anything that we do, it is at an aggregate level to say X number of customers bought this item, right? But it's not at the level of an individual to say Anand did this or Mani did this, etc. So all of that data that resides is essentially crunched, aggregated, and then even when it is a communication, that communication goes to a certain ID saying for delivery PN to this member because of the fact that this is the message that we need to send out to them. But beyond that, the data doesn't get shared at all. It's very important that we hold that data secure, because it's our customer's data and doesn't go beyond that. And even that, all the data that resides in the analytics platform is their transaction data and their browsing data. There's no personally identifiable information that exists.
Also, I mean, let's just add one more thing to that. I think it's also, you know, I mean, the other point to note is our primary business is e-commerce, right? And our objective with all of this data and everything that we said is to ensure that we send things that are useful to the customer. And that's the way in which we treat the data. So use it to enhance our offering to the customer. So, I mean, that way there's really no question of, you know, on the kind of things that you mentioned.
To the point of being paranoid about the data, right? Who gets access to the data? It's very, very limited access because it's sensitive and we want to be careful about it.